The rivers of America, the arteries of the nation, in big trouble. Next on Enviro Close Up. Kevin Coyle is with American Rivers, and Peter Levine is with the River Network. Kevin, the rivers of the United States, what kind of shape are they in?
Generally, most people think the rivers in the United States have improved very dramatically in the last 20 years or so because of the passage of the Clean Water Act. There have been a number of improvements in certain kinds of control of pollution. For example, what's called point source pollution, basically sticking a pipe in a river by industry or by a municipality, sewage problems, industrial waste, these kinds of things. The problem is there are other things going on with rivers that have put them in worse shape than they've ever been in.
Worse shape than they've ever been?
Yeah, one of the things is that in the 1980s, what's called non-point source pollution, and this basically is runoff from the land every time it rains, has become the leading cause of pollution. Agriculture, timber, building of shopping malls, parking lots, roads, and so forth. So non-point source pollution has risen way up over the past 20 years or so. And in addition to that, we've continuously built dams on our rivers. We've continuously put our rivers into ditches, or what is called channelization. And over time, what we're doing is we're putting our rivers in a sort of straitjacket. We're polluting them more, and we're closing them in and cutting them off from nature.
Kevin, your group, American Rivers, based in Washington, D.C., it's a national group, also was involved in Canada and Mexico. Do you see any kind of sensitivity on the national level to, you're saying that after EPA, after all the laws of the 1970s and 80s trying to restore the environment, to try to bring rivers back to life, that it's worse than it was. Do you see any thinking, any action happening that would suggest there'd be some remediation now?
Well, the news is not all bad, and I realize I've made it sound pretty grim, and in fact it is pretty grim. A third of the freshwater fish species in the United States are threatened or endangered at this point, or declining very badly. But there is some hope, there is some good news. Part of that is that the entire environmental movement of the country, at the government level, by private nonprofit organizations, by citizens, is focused more and more on protecting ecosystems, and the basic rules of ecology are very much coming into play now in a way that they really never have before. And the more that you learn about the protection of ecosystems, the more you understand how important it is to protect our rivers, and in particular what's called the watershed, or the whole river system itself. So there's good news at all levels of federal, state, local level, about the fact that people are becoming more aware that we need to protect our rivers. We need to think more holistically about them.
Peter Levine, your group is based in Portland, Oregon.
Yes.
Beautiful rivers in the northwest of this country, but terrible shape too. I mean, the Columbia River is a mess between radioactive pollution and the dams. I mean, speak about your group and what you folks are trying to do.
Well, we're a national organization as well. We had the good sense to base ourselves outside of Washington, D.C., which, as Kevin often calls it, is 60 square miles surrounded by reality. We decided to base in reality, so we are living in the Pacific Northwest, but doing a national work. Our mission is to help people save rivers, and we do that by supporting grassroots nonprofit groups around the country and statewide groups like the Massachusetts Watershed Coalition or the New Hampshire Rivers Council. And we work very closely with American Rivers on a number of major issues, national legislative campaigns, and working with grassroots groups around the United States.
One of the things about rivers is that, well, like, when you have a big patch of exquisite land, you know, Yellowstone or Yosemite or some, you know, then the government moves in and creates a national park, or sometimes a national forest, which doesn't really give the kind of protection. Now, you do have scenic rivers, and you do have rivers that government tries to preserve, but I don't think on the scale that government has moved in and tried to save beautiful patches of land. Am I wrong?
No, you're absolutely right. Less than 1% of the river miles in this country are protected as National Wild and Scenic Rivers. We have a long way to go to protect the outstanding resources that we have around this country. We need to look at rivers as the basic building blocks of our ecosystems. They're the veins and arteries of the watershed body, and they are the corridors for life and for biodiversity, for transportation, and for a whole range of human uses, including recreation.
I think, though, the problem with rivers, you know, trying to make more than 1% mm-hmm. of rivers places that people aren't supposed to foul up, is that they've been used as sewers for industry forever. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I mean, in the real politics of Washington, in the real politics of state houses across this country, you're fighting the plant that spews out its discharge now with a license from EPA mm-hmm. to do it in a certain way. I mean, you're fighting vested interests that have utterly no interest in mm-hmm. keeping rivers or making rivers pure.
When you look at the settlement pattern of the United States over the past two centuries, it's been a pattern of developing our rivers. There are 70,000 large-sized dams built on the rivers of the country. There are more than 2 million smaller dams built on our rivers. Many hundreds of thousands of miles have been straightened out and channelized for roads and for agriculture. There are go out west in the western part of the country where there's little rainfall, and the rivers are dried up in many cases. There's public policy that's been oriented toward using our rivers, and in addition to using them for waste removal, using them for agricultural irrigation and hydroelectric power production and so forth. And what that's doing is killing off the fish. I think it's interesting from a societal standpoint that we are a society that uses our rivers for waste removal and for drinking supply at the same time.
Now, not just to knock private industry here, but speaking of government, one of my least favorite governmental agencies is the Army Corps of Engineers. I mean, here you have the mentality of some of, I think, I don't want to denigrate all engineers, but a mentality of certain engineers that you can throw a monkey wrench into nature, everything is fine, you can remake nature, it's even better, and the mentality of certain military people that you can take on Mother Nature, you can reroute the Mississippi and so forth, and you could be able to withstand the next time there's a flood. The Army Corps of Engineers is a big problem here too, no?
Well, classic example was the Mississippi flood of 1993 in the summer. And when you really got down to it, you really looked at why that flood had such a high impact on the communities along the river, it was because the Corps of Engineers had been building levees for the past 65 years along the river and giving people a false sense of security that they would never be flooded. And in fact, what happened was that the floodplain for the river was cut off from the river itself, so the water couldn't fan out anymore. And the levees held the river in, so the water levels went up and went down with more fury, in the long run causing more problems. And it's only in this past Congress, for the first time, that Congress said to the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, instead of rebuilding the levees, why don't we put our emphasis on moving some people out of the floodplain.
What's particularly amazing about the Mississippi situation is that the Army Corps knows how to do it right. They did it right here on the Charles River in Boston. They bought wetlands, they preserved the natural floodplains, and they eliminated the need for levees and for dams. What they need to do is apply that lesson that happened here 30 years ago nationally and make sure that they don't repeat the mistakes over and over again that they've repeated for the last 100 years around the country.
What's wrong with the Army Corps? I mean, I think the Charles River Project was a bit of an anomaly. It's unusual for the Army Corps of Engineers to be, you know, sensitive to nature.
Yeah. It is an anomaly in the history of the Corps, but it's a very important anomaly,
yes.
And it's one that we need to model. And it's one that the rest of the country needs to know about.
I think the answer to what's wrong with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is not so much a question of what's wrong, but why do they do what they do? Why do they always, given an environmental problem, take an engineering solution to that problem as the only way out, when they need to add an arrow to their quiver? They need to use the laws of nature in addition to the laws of engineering, and the problem is they are an organization of engineers.
Yes, we'll be back with Enviro Close-Up and about our troubled rivers. That's the focus of this Enviro Close-Up right after this.
The dump site we're proposing is perfectly safe. Trust me.
The people who tell you that nuclear waste dumps are safe are stretching the truth. Trucks carrying radioactive waste will be traveling through our neighborhoods, so no area is safe.
As for our track record, accidents will happen. Clean it up.
Nuclear waste. The problem is bigger than you think.
I dreamed all of the animals will be safe forever.
I dreamed our water got clean again.
I would like more trees to grow.
And the ozone layer will get strong again.
Fish are neat, and I don't want any of them to die.
I dreamed our Earth will get well again, because everyone who lived here started doing things to help it.
Help our planet to get better.
Earth Day is April 22nd.
Don't worry, the safety valve is absolutely reliable. There is no need for concern. And anyway, once it's there, we might as well use it. Trust us.
Kevin Coyle of American Rivers. Let's talk about the endangered rivers in this country. I mean, we're talking thousands and thousands of rivers in big trouble. Perhaps you can speak about some that are in the biggest of trouble.
Well, American Rivers once a year comes out with our list of the nation's most endangered rivers. This past year, 1993 and 1994, we listed the Rio Grande River in Texas and Mexico as the nation's most endangered river. What we have going on there in the border country is a number of American corporations have located on the south side of the border in Mexico so that they can take advantage of inexpensive wages and they can take advantage of lax environmental laws. And as a result, there are terrible pollution problems going on in the lower Rio Grande. Moreover, people are attracted to the area. People from Mexico are attracted to the border country by the hundreds of thousands, and they get into these shanty, shack-oriented communities where there's no sewage treatment or whatever. In Brownsville, Texas, which is near the mouth of the Rio Grande, in the past couple years there have been many dozens of anencephalitic children born, the children born without brains, and it's environmental causes that are what that's all about. So we're back in the dark ages in the border country when it comes to the Rio Grande River and environmental issues.
But also in your list are many rivers in the domestic 48 of the United States. I mean, perhaps you can speak about some of those rivers in specific.
Well, there are different threats to rivers. So rivers that are high on our list of endangered rivers in the Northwest, for example, you mentioned earlier the Columbia and Snake River systems and the decline of the Pacific salmon. We have a program that's oriented toward reforming the operations of dams out there so that the juvenile fish can make it downstream. Here in New England, one of the top endangered rivers is the Penobscot River in Maine, which is in one light a major Atlantic salmon restoration river, but most recently has been threatened by a new hydroelectric power dam that is proposed for that river. There are the Yellowstone River in Montana is threatened by a major gold mine that would put toxic tailings into its headwaters. There are rivers down south that are threatened by pollution. There's just a wide range of very, very specific, dramatic threats to rivers all through the country.
Peter, who's like in charge of the shop here? I mean, who's like responsible for the health of the river system of America?
It varies from jurisdiction to jurisdiction and area to area around the country, because on the federal level, the agency that is most involved with river systems through the implementation of the Clean Water Act is the Environmental Protection Agency. But there's a conflicting mishmash of agencies throughout the federal government, state, and local government. And within the federal government, you have all the public lands agencies, the Bureau of Land Management, Bureau of Reclamation, the U.S. Forest Service. On state level, you have various state environmental agencies, interstate agencies like the New England Interstate Water Pollution Control Commission, and any alphabet soup you can think of.
You got a lot of money, you got a lot of agencies, you got a lot of bureaucrats. Do you have any real action?
There are a lot of good initiatives going on. We're coming out of 12 years of anti-environment action by the federal government in particular, and that's beginning to change with a new administration. There's a long way to go, particularly on river efforts. What we're seeing, however, is very promising and interesting is that agencies are changing their focus on how they deal with rivers from an end-of-the-pipe solution to pollution prevention and watershed approaches. We're no longer just looking at the river corridor and the flow of water in the river. We're looking at the entire land-based river watershed and realizing in our environmental regulation that if you're going to protect a river, you have to protect the land that surrounds it and drains into it. And you have to deal with air pollution, and you have to deal with solid waste. You have to deal with habitat loss and development, population growth, the whole range of environmental issues. And that's where rivers are extremely important and are the focal point, I think, for the next 10 years on how we deal with environmental cleanup.
Now, what should people do, Kevin? I mean, we can't leave it to the bureaucrats, that's for sure.
Well, there's so many ways that people can help. Once a year, there's an event called, in May, called National River Cleanup Week. And they ought to contact River Network or American Rivers and ask about how to get involved.
Before we go further, the address first of American Rivers.
We're at 801 Pennsylvania Avenue Southeast, Washington, D.C., and the zip code is 20003.
Just send a card to you and get literature, and you can join, right?
Yep, you can become a member, and we can sign you up.
And River Network?
River Network is at Post Office Box 8787, Portland, Oregon, 97207. We have a nationwide 800 number that you can call our River Clearinghouse and get all kinds of free technical assistance and advice on any kind of river protection and pollution issue. And that's 800-423-6747.
Okay, we got a week in May that something can be done, but a lot of other weeks in the year.
Well, people who just want to get involved should, you know, there's a range of things that they can do. They can learn about their local river. That's important. They can get in touch with their local planning commission. They can get in touch with their local government leaders and ask questions. If there's a water river group in their area, they ought to find out about it and get in contact. And what they'll find is they begin to ask questions, and they ask, who's working on the rivers? What are the issues associated with our local rivers? Is that there will be opportunities for them to get involved and to become advocates for river conservation. I think another thing is that more and more the more professional environmental advocates are learning about the science of rivers. They're learning about natural science and how that can be part of the change, how they can study rivers more and as a result come up with better policies on how to address river problems. People can get in touch with river issues at just about any level they wish.
We'll be back with Enviro Close Up on America's Troubled Rivers right after this.
It's coming. The most significant event in automotive history. It's coming. The end of the age of the automobile.
I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
you're not recycling, you're throwing it all away.
Paul Levine of the River Network, your organization has been trying to spur grassroots action to save rivers in America. Describe what you've been doing in that regard.
Well, we work with a number of different programs with grassroots groups around the country. There's a tremendous surge in grassroots river protection activism around this country. 3 years ago, 4 years ago, there were about 1,600 grassroots river protection groups scattered among the 50 states. This year, in our latest river activist directory, we've identified over 2,500, and it's growing monthly. There were seven statewide river protection organizations in the country 2 years ago. There are now 17. By the end of 1994, I think we'll see about 21. So that rivers are catching on. I think it's the watersheds and river protection is the movement of the 90s for the environment, in the environment.
Well, I think rivers can be saved too. I mean, relatively speaking, I remember 30 years ago as a young reporter in Cleveland, Ohio, and the problem with the Cayuga River was that it would go on fire every now and then. There was so much petroleum and what have you on that river that, I mean, it would really, like, you know, ignite. Yeah. It's improved, the Cayuga River. I mean, it's gotten far better.
Yeah.
I would think it has still a good way to go.
It does, and what we've seen is a change that Kevin mentioned earlier over the past 20 years is that the visible pollution is gone. The sludge and the gasoline and the dyes from the paper mills is gone. What we don't see now is the loss of habitat, the loss of riparian habitat, wetlands along the banks, and the loss of species and the loss of biodiversity, the loss of fish and clams and crayfish in the rivers. And that's what we're dealing with now, and it's much more insidious and it's harder for the public to get a handle on. It's also much more detrimental over the long haul to the health of our river systems. And the Cayuga is a great example. It no longer catches on fire. It also has many fewer fish in it and other species than it had historically. And we've got to figure out a way to restore the habitat that allows those organisms to live.
The other thing about rivers, I've done a lot of work myself, did a couple of books on nuclear power, and when you plunk a nuclear power plant down on a river, and about half of the nuclear power plants in the United States are there right on a river, the water goes into the nuclear power plant, take the Indian Point plants, just 28 miles north of New York City, and goes out of the nuclear power plants, and particularly the boiling water reactors discharge that water with a level of radioactivity. I mean, that, I think, is like an impossible problem. How do you folks deal with that?
We really have not been able to deal with that, and it is a major problem with respect. Nuclear power plants, particularly when they use the water cooling towers, these very high, 500-foot high towers that we see, really have use an incredible amount of water. They must be near a river or a major lake in order to do that. And we've never really dealt with that issue. Moreover, where there are nuclear development facilities, such as the Hanford Reserve out in the state of Washington, which where they've been building nuclear weapons for years, or the Savannah River Plant, these two are very river-dependent facilities where they put low-grade radioactive waste into the rivers. And again, no one's really been able to figure out a way to deal with that
problem.
Well,
that's what I think damaged the Columbia River more than anything.
It's a significant damage.
Facility, yeah.
Although what has damaged the salmon in the Columbia River more than anything are the dams. And one of the major initiatives, I think, over the next 15 to 20 years is to remove some of those major dams on the Columbia and on the Snake Rivers. And until we deal with that and remove some of those dams, we're not going to restore salmon to that river system.
Well, whether it's fish or people, it's life being damaged by the destruction of our rivers. Back to nuclear, one nuclear plant, a big one, like an 800 to 1,000 megawatt plant, requires 1 million gallons of water a minute as coolant moving into that plant. So you can see how much river water those plants consume and change and
heat up and send back. Yeah.
Sometimes the Limerick plants, which are near Philadelphia, the water goes through Limerick before it's then sent to Philadelphia as drinking water. So I mean these literally are the arteries of life, all sorts of life, and they just can't be taken for granted, and they can't be allowed to just continue to be cesspools.
It's an important thing for every member of the public to keep in mind that physically their bodies are two-thirds water, and that most of the drinking supplies of the United States are river water, and not many people really understand that. It's a very important thing that you're raising.
And there's no other place, I mean, if there's no other place to get the water. I mean, certain areas of the country you have underground water systems, aquifers and so forth, but basically, I mean, that's it. That's the water. That's the fluid of life. And if we blow it, we blow it.
In some systems, the Merrimack system where I grew up, it's been a historical change from dependence on groundwater for drinking water in New England. The groundwater has now been polluted by toxic chemicals, and the communities are going to the river for drinking water supply. So it's more important than ever that we have a clean and healthy river system.
We'll be back with Enviro Close Up right after this. This has been Carl Grossman with Enviro Close Up. Thanks for watching.